Dream Team, how Michael, Magic, Larry, Charles, and the greatest team of all time conquered the world and changed the game of basketball forever. By Jack McCallum. Narrated by Dick Hill. Copyright 2012 by Jack McCallum. This unabridged audiobook is recorded by arrangement with Ballantine Books, an imprint of the Random House Publishing Group, a division of Random House Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. The older I get, the less interested I am in what's new, and the more interested I am in what endures. James Hines. To live is to fly, low and high, so shake the dust off your wings and the sleep out of your eyes. Towns Van Zandt. I don't know nothing about Angola, but Angola's in trouble. Charles Barkley. 1992 Dream Team. Thumbnail Sketches. Barkley, Charles, 6'4", forward. TNT commentator whose fame has grown exponentially since retirement. Boldly continues to play celebrity golf despite universally lampooned swing. Leading scorer for Dream Team. Known in Barcelona for rambling along Las Ramblas and elbowing an Angolan. Bird, Larry, 6'9", forward. At this writing, still general manager of the Indiana Pacers, but longing for golden years. Limited by aching back in Barcelona that led to post-Olympics retirement. Struck up unlikely Dream Team friendship with Patrick Ewing. Engaged Chris Mullen in legendary horse shootout. Drexler, Clyde, 6'7", guard. Businessman, golfer, dancing with the stars veteran. Wants to be NBA head coach. Happy to have been Dream Teamer, but unhappy he was added late. Remembered for wearing two left shoes to practice and trying to get away with it. Does not believe Michael Jordan was better than he was. Ewing, Patrick, 7 foot center. Assistant coach with Orlando Magic, and perturbed he's been unable to get interview for head coaching job. Much more popular with Dreamer teammates than with press. Harry half of Harry and Larry. Johnson, Irvin, 6'9", guard. Guiding force behind Magic Johnson Enterprises, having made good on long ago vow to become big-time player in business world. Sometimes irritated Dreamers with "it's my team" attitude, but changed millions of attitudes worldwide about HIV and AIDS. At this writing, scheduled to be immortalized on Broadway along with Bird in play about their seminal importance to NBA. Jordan, Michael, 6'6", guard, chairman of the Charlotte Bobcats, trying to make it right after bad experience running Washington Wizards. Serenaded aggravated Magic with "Be Like Mike" solo after legendary intra-squad scrimmage win. Acknowledged by all Dreamers as team's alpha male and greatest of all time, with Magic holding out just a little and Drexler holding out a lot. Leitner Christian, 6'11", forward. His BD Ventures, co-run with ex-Duke teammate Brian Davis, has had cash flow problems. At this writing, wants to get into coaching. Seems serious about changing spoiled brat image. Earned way onto Dream Team by being immortal college player. Malone, Carl, 6'9", forward. Serious big game hunter who wants back into NBA in some capacity. Work ethic was inspiration to several other members of Dream Team. Jordan Magic woof fests at practice got under his skin. Mullen, Chris, 6'6", guard forward. Successful as ESPN commentator, but might get another shot at front office job after failure in Golden State. Barcelona sharpshooting, 6'19 overall, 5'38 on three-pointers. A firm selection to skeptics, and dream nod reaffirmed benefits of sobriety to him. Pippen Scottie, 6'8" guard forward, has had serious money problems, but with commentating gig and reality show wife, never far from public eye. Hinted LeBron James was better than Jordan, then took it back. Kind of. Showed he belonged on Dream Team with world-class versatility. Robinson David, 7'1 center. Runs private school in San Antonio called Carver Academy. Faith-based activities govern his life, mostly outsider to other members of Dream Team, but universally respected. Teamed with A. Marsalis for Rooftop Duet in Barcelona. Stockton John, 6'1 guard. Full-time chauffeur for his family in his hometown Spokane and couldn't be happier. Tutored star women's guard Courtney Vandersloot at alma mater Gonzaga. Broken leg limited Dream Team play. Daly Chuck, coach. Died of cancer in 2009. Vowed never to take a time out in Barcelona and didn't. Everybody loved him. Everybody misses him. Introduction. You have a tape? Michael Jordan asks. Of that game? I do, I say. Man, everybody asked me about that game, he says. It was the most fun I ever had on a basketball court. It is reflective of the enduring legend of the Dream Team, arguably the most dominant squad ever assembled in any sport, that we are referring not to a real game, but to an intra-squad scrimmage that the Dreamers played in Monte Carlo before the 1992 Olympic Games. The United States engaged in 14 games in that summer, two decades ago, 6 in a pre-Olympic qualifying tournament, and 8 as they breezed to the gold medal in Barcelona. And the closest any opponent came was a fine Croatia team, which lost by 32 points in the gold medal final. The common matrices of statistical comparison, you see, are simply not relevant in the case of the Dream Team, whose members could be evaluated only when they played one another. A video of that game is the holy grail of basketball, and the account of it is here in Chapter 28. A perfect storm hit Barcelona in the summer of the Dream Team. Everything came together. The team members were almost exclusively NBA veterans at or near the apex of their individual fame. The world, having been offered only bite-sized nuggets of NBA games, was waiting for them, since Barcelona was the first Olympics in which professional basketball players were allowed to compete. They were a star-spangled export for a country that still held a position of primacy around the world. It couldn't have been scripted any better. And when the Dreamers finally released all that star power into a collective effort, the show was better than everyone thought it would be. And everyone had thought it would be pretty damn good. They were Johnny Cash at Folsom Prison, the Allman Brothers at Fillmore East, Santana at Woodstock. If it would have happened today, says Larry Bird, it would have been one of those reality shows. The names, Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, Larry Bird, Charles Barkley, remain familiar to fans two decades later, their cultural relevancy quotient still quite high. It's not just that an engaging Dream Teamer, who's now an A-list TV star, partially inspired Danger Mouse and CeeLo Green to christen their hip-hop duo Gnarls Barkley, or that Magic Johnson, Red Hot Chili Peppers and Kanye West, Scottie Pippen, Jay-Z, Karl Malone, The Transplants, and Michael Jordan, impossible to count the references, have been subjects in song. Consider this. The name of John Stockton, a buttoned-down, no-nonsense point guard, is on a track in a 2011 release by Brooklyn rapper Nemo Akita, and the popular NBA 2K12 video game features Jordan, Magic, and Bird on the box cover, not contemporary players such as LeBron James, Dirk Nowitzki, and Derrick Rose. The Dream Teamers are never far from the news, even the crime news. Not long ago, a convict tattooed Jordan's Jumpman logo onto his forehead, and an accused rapist in Arkansas, in an interview after he was captured, described his run from the cops this way. "I was like Michael Jordan, man. Gone." An armed robber asked that his sentence be increased from 30 years to 33 years to honor Larry Bird's number. Yet the written record of that team and that time is not particularly large. The Dream Team, like the dinosaurs, walked the earth in the pre-social media age. Beyond newspaper stories, there is no detailed daily log of their basketball activities. Bird shot around today, but his back is sore, and no enduring exclamations of chance meetings around Barcelona. "OMG, just met Chaz Bark at bar and he kissed me on cheek. He's not really fat, LOL." There is much of the story to be told in the fresh light of history. There is little doubt that the Dream Team, like that red-haired lass you met years ago at a pub in Dublin, looks better in the soft focus blur of nostalgia. "This is now the Dream Team of blessed memories," says NBA Commissioner David Stern. "They were the guy with the piccolo and the scrappy band of revolutionaries marching off to war. They forget Charles elbowing the Angolan, Michael and the others covering up their logo, the cries of, 'Why are we sending these teams? You're just trying to humiliate the other nations.' Over the years, it's become beatified." None of that is forgotten in this audiobook, Mr. Stern. The Dream Team was indeed forged amid conflicts athletic and bureaucratic, and touched by tragedy and controversy when it returned home after an Olympics that, yes, was layered in a gauzy romanticism. All that is part of the story. The book is, in fact, a panoptic survey of that entire generation, in large part because the members of the Dream Team represented the central characters in the compelling drama of pro basketball from the mid-1980s to the early 1990s, a golden age for the NBA that ended when the fairy tale world of the Dream Team itself ended in August 1992. The narrative unfolds in roughly, emphasis on roughly, chronological fashion. It struck me as crucial to give definition to the players before they were Dream Teamers. Michael Jordan as the young hero of the 1984 Olympics, Scottie Pippen as the neophyte struggling to play alongside his infinitely more famous Chicago Bulls teammate, Charles Barkley as the unbridled wild child, and, of course, the 1980s rivalry of Magic Johnson and Larry Bird. Then, too, the selection process, how the team came together, is in some ways more riveting than the games themselves. It was political theater, a kind of convention without the pom-poms, a process in which backstabbing and rivalries, current and ancient, all played a part. But it was also important to provide glimpses of the players as they are now, some in their hometowns, Phoenix, Houston, San Antonio, Spokane, some in their places of business, Charlotte and Orlando. These are defined as interludes. So there are stops and starts to the narrative, which emerges as more like a Magic yo-yo dribble than a Barkley straight-ahead bowl-over-any-obstacle dash to the hoop. Like all of us, in later life they have found failure, some as husbands or fathers, others as coaches, general managers, or businessmen. But from a basketball perspective, they approached perfection. They are history writ large, the greatest team of all time by such a wide margin, says Dallas Mavericks general manager Donnie Nelson, who coached against them in the Olympics, that I can't even think of who's in second place. The best barometer of what this team meant to history is limned by the words of one of its most prominent members, a man who won five NBA championships, three MVP awards, one NCAA title, and an untold number of popularity contests. For me, the Dream Team is number one of anything I've done in basketball, says Magic Johnson, because there will never be another team like it. There can't be. Prologue. The Dream Team Gets a Name. Barcelona, 1992. I knew it was a bad idea from the beginning. I swear I did. But David Dupree, my friend and colleague from USA Today, kept pushing it. We've covered the Dream Team from the beginning, said David. We should get our picture taken with them. It's no big deal. It'll be something to look back on. Taking a photo with famous athletes seemed like the last thing David would suggest, but such was the overheated temperature of the times when the phrase Dream Team was on the lips of everyone in the world, not just the sports world, when helicopters dotted the bleached Spanish sky like fireflies to protect the millionaire players, when snipers sat on the roof of their hotel in Barcelona to take down potential assassins wanting to enter the history books, when adoring fans congregated around the clock just to catch a fleeting glimpse of the 12 Americans who were in the process of storming to the gold medal and rewriting basketball history. I'll run it by Magic, said Carl Malone when we asked the mailman about the photo. Carl, David, and I were having dinner in Barcelona. The other diners were staring at us. Staring at Malone, actually. I had gotten a restaurant recommendation from a friend. This was before the days of go on the internet and check out Zagat, and it was a bad choice. They brought out quail eggs for an appetizer. Man, I don't eat this shit, said Malone, a country boy from Louisiana, who never hesitated to remind you of that fact. I don't either, I protested. Do I look like a quail egg guy? I don't know what you white people eat, Malone said, winking at Dupree, also an African-American. When we finished, Carl promised to check on the photo op and get back to us. We clear that stuff with Magic, said Malone. He's the captain. There was no better indication that the Dream Team had become one big, happy family than Malone's unquestioned acceptance of Magic as ceremonial captain. Malone had never been a huge Magic fan, and just a few months later, the mailman would openly question whether Magic should be allowed to play in the NBA, given the fact that Johnson had the AIDS virus. Then, too, there had been several times during that glorious summer of 1992 when Malone had tired of the relentless chatter of Magic, the go-to spokesman, a man who, as Scottie Pippen puts it, always needs the microphone. And Malone wasn't the only one. The days went by. The United States rolled up easy win after easy win. Barcelona and the world beyond continued to watch in slack-jawed awe, and the team continued to bathe in this heady marinade of adulation, testosterone, and 40-point victories. We heard nothing about the photo op until about a half hour before the Dream Team was to play the gold medal game against Croatia on August 8th. Now? I asked Brian McIntyre, the congenial and consistently competent head of NBA public relations. Christ, they're going for the gold medal. But Brian escorted David and me behind the members-only ropes that led to the most famous locker room in the world, just as the Dream Team was emerging to take the floor. Let's go. Let's get it done. Let's take it to them. I couldn't separate the voices, but there was much clamor and clapping. It suggested Croatia was about to enter a world of pain, which it subsequently did. Suddenly, Magic halted the procession so that, I'm mortified even as I write this, Dupree and I could be photographed with the team. It was as if a band of brothers on the way to battle had been halted to share hors d'oeuvres with Anderson Cooper. There were several expressions of what the hell are we doing confusion, but the team stopped, Dupree and I slipped into the front row, and NBA photographer Andy Bernstein prepared to take the least compelling photo of his illustrious career. And as we posed, my groin tight, flop sweat soaking my brow, praying that this moment would soon be over, I heard a voice from the back row, one with a distinctive Hoosier twang. "Hey, Jack," drawled Larry Bird. "Later on, you want to blow us?" If you'll permit a metaphorical extension of Bird's transitive verb, and who among you would not, this was the most belated gang of warriors since the Spartan army. As the members of the Dream Team, one by one, had accepted invitations to become the first NBA players to participate in the Olympic Games, they understood that they were signing on to something special. But from the first moment they came together to practice in San Diego on June 21, 1992, they had been the central players in an unprecedented spectacle. An adoring public and almost as adoring media bestowing upon them attention that can only be described as pornographic. It's become so commonplace to describe them as rock stars that I won't even do it, although I guess I just did. They were Jagger mugging in an open limo, Princess Di flashing her come-hither smile at an Elton John concert, Liz Taylor air-kissing Michael Jackson at an AIDS benefit. By the time the Dream Team landed in Barcelona, thousands having gathered just to watch their plane touch down in twilight at El Prat de Llobregat Aeropuerto, they knew that they were on a march into immortality, not a footnote to sports history, but an entire chapter. An accident of timing, that most blessed breeder of success, put me in the middle of all this. From 1981 to 1985, I had been at Sports Illustrated as a kind of relief pitcher, long man more than closer, as the second, third, or even fourth backup on pro and college football, pro and college basketball, boxing, baseball, and track and field. In the winter of 1982, I wrote 8 stories on 8 different sports in 8 weeks, including the World Championship of Squash, held in New York City at the Yale Club, to which I was denied access until I had purchased a sport coat and tie. I am not suggesting that this equates to, say, walking through rice paddies and swiping leeches off your body to cover the Vietnam War, as the late David Halberstam, who became an NBA chronicler at a plane considerably elevated from my own, once did. It's merely to say that I needed a stable home. And in the fall of 1985, I got one when managing editor Mark Mulvoy put me as the number one man on the NBA beat. It is the dirty little secret of journalism, maybe it's not such a secret, that you're only as good as your material. And man, I parachuted into a valley of material so rich and fertile that only the worst kind of hack could have screwed it up. Under Mulvoy, Sports Illustrated was largely a front-runner's magazine. That is, we wrote about winners and put winners on the cover. In the years before Barcelona, I wrote dozens and dozens of stories about these men who were, as we realized even at the time, creating a kind of golden age of pro hoops. Along the way, I was accused by readers and friends of variously favoring Jordan and the Bulls, Bird and the Celtics, and Magic and the Lakers. Years later, after he had become a general manager in Indiana, Bird would usually greet me with, "You blown Magic lately?" The man does like that verb. I thought I did an adequate job of covering the beat honestly, tossing out criticisms along with encomiums. To varying degrees, stories I wrote in the 1980s and early 1990s angered Jordan, Barkley, Drexler, and Ewing. But part of what made this the golden age, from a journalist's perspective, was that these guys understood the implicit contract between athlete and writer, that it was not a crime against humanity when someone wrote something bad about them, that journalism was not to be confused with hagiography, even if they didn't know what hagiography is. It's a system of checks and balances, as someone described the relationship between athletes and the press to me not long ago. That was Michael Jordan. I feel fortunate to have come along when I did, and I apologize in advance for making myself a small part of this story. "You can't help it," one editor told me. "You were along for the ride." I was a minor league Cameron Crowe, almost famous, walking in the shadow of a dream, as did Mr. Dimmesdale, Nathaniel Hawthorne's tortured minister in The Scarlet Letter. I even had something to do with the nomenclature and explosion of the Dream Team phenomenon. In February 1991, well after the announcement that pros would be allowed into the Olympics, but well before any player had publicly committed, I wrote a Sports Illustrated cover story projecting what the team could be and naming my choices for starters: Jordan, Magic, Ewing, Barkley, and Malone. I thought that they were the five best players in the game at that time. I would have had the 35-year-old Bird on my starting team, though he hadn't made an All-Star team since 1988. It wouldn't have been a totally ceremonial choice, because the man could still play. But he had already made noises that his back was too creaky, and he probably would not go to Barcelona. I took him at his word. We gathered those five together at the 1991 All-Star Game in Charlotte for a photo that had taken months to set up, clearing the time with the players, their agents, and the NBA. I had been such a pain in the ass about it with the players that when Magic entered the room where the photo was to be taken, he looked at me and said with some exasperation, "Okay, you happy now?" With more prescience, I should have seen on that day what the U.S. Olympic team would become. Despite the fact that the shoot took place in a secured area, hundreds of onlookers pressed in when they caught glimpses of the players. They pushed against the door and tried to find a rear entrance to the room, hoping for just a glance at their heroes. It's beyond obvious that any individual fame the players had, which was considerable, had increased exponentially by their being together. And in Barcelona, it would increase exponentially, exponentially. But all I remember thinking was, now this is interesting. The opening to my story in the following week's magazine read, "It's a red, white, and blue dream. The five players who grace this week's cover playing together, determined to restore America's lost basketball dignity in the 1992 Olympic Games in Barcelona." What's the chance of this dream coming true? Not bad. Not bad at all. The cover photo was accompanied by the tagline, "Dream Team," right up by the Sports Illustrated logo. So there it was for the first time. Dream Team. Years later, I was credited with coming up with that magical appellation, but I always tried to set the record straight. Yes, I had used the word dream twice, but an editor had put dream and team together on the cover. I even tried to find out exactly who had come up with it at the office, but couldn't do it. SI cover lines are written democratically, by trial and error. Chances are there had been multiple possibilities. Golden Dream, Red, White, Blue, and Ready, Look Out World! But Dream Team it was, and Dream Team stuck. To this day, Barkley believes he was one of the first five players chosen by the committee because he was on the cover. Trust me, he wasn't among the first five to be picked. Once in a while, something just clicks, and that was the case here, says Rick Welts, now the president and COO of the Golden State Warriors, but then the NBA's resident marketing genius. After that cover, the idea of Dream Team really took off. I'm proud of two things in my career. That the This Week's Sign of the Apocalypse that still runs in the scorecard section of SI was my idea. And that I had something to do with coining the phrase Dream Team. NBA Commissioner David Stern said to me recently, "The fact that all of this took off was a delicious accident. We didn't even name it. Maybe, God forbid, you did." In my office at home, I have only a few photos chronicling my years covering the NBA. The photo of Dupree and me with the Dream Team is clipped to a bulletin board, barely visible, a nearly capsized vessel floating in a sea of family photos. I never had it blown up. You can tell it's an afterthought photo, the kind in which everyone poses for a second or two, then keeps going. Christian Leitner gazes to one side, not even bothering to look at the photographer, and John Stockton is not in the frame at all. My guess is he just continued onto the floor. I'm in the front row, partially obscuring Bird's face, though not, alas, his commentary. Part 1. Before the Dream. Chapter 1. The Inspector of Meat. Pros in the Olympics? It was his idea, and don't let anyone tell you different. He first came to the United States in January 1974, dispatched by his boss to study up on American basketball. He didn't speak the language, didn't know the customs, and settled into the basketball hotbed of Billings, Montana, because that's where he could secure free lodging with a Yugoslavian family. This stranger in a strange land was named Boris Stankovic. He was 6 months from his 49th birthday, and he had come on behalf of FIBA. At the time, not more than a dozen Americans knew what it stood for, Fédération Internationale de Basketball, where it was headquartered, at the time in an apartment in Munich, later in Geneva, and what the hell it did. Governed amateur basketball in all parts of the world, except the United States. You cannot know basketball if you do not know basketball in the United States, Stankovic was told by R. William Jones, who, as Secretary General, ran FIBA with a bow tie, a lit cigar, and a dictator's fist. So Stankovic came and was instantly seduced by the college games he saw live. UCLA's red-headed phenomenon Bill Walton was his favorite player, and the NBA games he saw on television. For much of his early adult life, Stankovic had been a meat inspector in Belgrade. My job was to look over the meat and cheese and, as you do here, put a stamp on it, said Stankovic when I interviewed him in Istanbul in the summer of 2010. He is retired now, but comes to many events as the Eminence Grise of international basketball. Stankovic had earned a degree in veterinary medicine in 1945 from the University of Belgrade. It was natural in our country that veterinarians looked after the meat and cheese because it has to do with animals, no? The type of meat Stankovic most liked to inspect, though, was the cured leather on a basketball. Even as he was arising at 5 a.m. to take up his meat stamp and lace up his white apron, basketball is what moved his spirit. He was an earthbound, fundamentally sound, low post forward who played 36 games for the Yugoslavian national team. One of his proudest moments was playing for his country in the first world championship organized by FIBA, which took place in Argentina in 1950. We finished 9th, says Stankovic, chuckling, and there were 9 teams. One of his enduring regrets was that he never participated in the Olympics as a player. The Yugoslavs were a tall, tough, and lean people, hardened by wars, civil and foreign. In the Balkan area of Yugoslavia, where Stankovic was born, the people measure eras not by war and peace, but by war and non-war. When Boris was 19, he and his father, Vasilije, a lawyer who fought for Serbian nationalism, were imprisoned by an invading Russian army. After 2 months, Boris was released, but Vasilije was executed by firing squad and buried in a common grave. Even today, Stankovic does not know where. Stankovic was put on a blacklist that later kept him from becoming a medical doctor, his desired profession, and forced him to veterinary school, his way of staying in the field of medicine. Like most of his countrymen from that generation, he identified with the Serbian rebels who had squirmed under foreign rule for 5 centuries. They lived in groups and learned to cooperate, to work with each other, Stankovic said. We grew up with that in our blood. We Serbians have never had much success in the individual sports, but our team sports are very, very strong. We have a proficiency in and an aptitude for sports that require a lot of teamwork. Stankovic's knowledge of the game and overall intelligence, virtually anyone who talks about him invariably mentions his brains, enabled him to rise steadily as a coach and executive. By the time he was 30, he was the most important non-player in Yugoslavian basketball, even as he continued to inspect meat and had already become active in FIBA. In 1966, Oransola Cantu, a team in the Italian Professional League, came calling in search of a coach, and Stankovic left his homeland. I went for the money, says Stankovic. Italy was the richest league. He was reviled by many Italians as an outsider, but later grew to be loved, as winners usually are, when his team captured the championship in 1968. That's when R. William Jones beckoned him back. Jones had seen the future of FIBA, and its name was Boris Stankovic. Jones, who died in 1981, months after suffering a stroke during a dinner at the 1980 Moscow Olympics, was the kind of man for whom the term grudging admiration seems to have been invented. Born in Rome to a British father and French mother, he had earned a degree from Springfield College, where Dr. James Naismith hung up his first peach basket. Jones was a very international guy, Stankovic's words, a combination that made him an undeniable basketball visionary. But he was also the classic amateur sport pasha, imperious and intractable. For basketball people in the United States, Jones left his enduring imprimatur by allowing the Soviets 3 chances to win the gold medal against the U.S. team on September 9, 1972, at the star-crossed Olympic Games in Munich. Stankovic was a long way from being an established leader when he first came to the United States on that intelligence-gathering trip in 1974. He was just an outsider trying to learn the nuances of American basketball while also trying to learn how to order a hamburger. He was granted a papal audience with John Wooden. We talked basketball, so it was easy to communicate, he says, but mostly he was left on his own to watch, listen, and compare. And what happened was that a basketball junkie was transfixed by the American players, college and pro. It just seemed to be a different game, says Stankovic, smiling at the memory. Faster, but also fundamentally sound. You watched a guy like Bill Walton for 1 minute, and you could see that his level was so much higher than anyone we had in Europe. FIBA's rules at the time banned professionals from playing under the FIBA banner, and the rules of FIBA were the rules of Olympic basketball. So it was, so it had always been, and so everyone thought it would always be. The hypocrisy, of course, was that de facto professionals were playing anyway, since international basketball teams always comprised their country's top players, even if they were officially listed as soldiers or policemen. With the lone exception of Stankovic, there was no push to include American pros in the Olympics, since the supremacy of even American collegians was considered self-evident, the anomaly of 1972 notwithstanding. Plus, it was simply part of our sporting ethos that the Olympics were for our college players. The NBA and the Olympics were planets rotating in different solar systems. But the inspector of meat, an outsider, didn't see it that way. As he watched the pro stars of the 1970s on TV, among them Oscar Robertson and Jerry West, plus his two favorites Walt Frazier and Pete Maravich, it began to gnaw at him that America's best players would never participate in the Olympic Games. "The hypocrisy was what got to me," said Stankovic, "and there was a practical side. My concern was trying to make the game of basketball strong, to grow it, and yet there was this separation. It became impossible for me to tolerate." There might have been a self-serving side, too. Stankovic saw himself as the messiah of hoops, the person to lift the game above King Football. And he was irritated by the fact that his organization, the "We Have the Final Say Court of All Appeals for World Basketball," came with an asterisk because it wasn't even a blip on the NBA's radar screen. Whatever the variety of reasons, Stankovic came back to Munich and told Jones that dropping the amateurs-only clause, thus clearing the way for America's best players to compete in the Olympics, should be a FIBA goal. A truly anarchic idea, given the socio-political sports climate. The times might have been a changin', but not in the International Olympic Committee, IOC, where Avery Brundage, a loathsome individual, a clear number one on the list of tin pot despots who have run sports over the centuries, held fast to the concept of shamateurism. Stankovic isn't sure what Jones really thought of his idea, but his boss's instruction was crystal clear. He said, "Don't bother," remembers Stankovic. Or, as you say in America, "Don't go there." And for the next decade and a half, no one except Boris Stankovic went there. Like many influential men and women throughout history, the inspector of meat is overlooked. He has never met Magic Johnson or Larry Bird, and the only time he has crossed paths with Michael Jordan was in the 1984 Olympics, in the pre-Dream Team days. But whatever revisionist history might eventually be written, remember this. The Dream Team resulted from the vision of Boris Stankovic. It was not a secret plot hatched by David Stern to grow the game, one of the commissioner's favorite phrases. It was not the result of a crusade by the NBA's marketing demons to sell $200 authentics in Europe, even though that was an eventuality. It was not frustration built up by the increasing reality that inroads were being made on the United States' claim of basketball supremacy. The idea germinated in the mind of the inspector of meat from Belgrade. Chapter 2. The Chosen One. Sneaker porn is born. It was some rare time away from Bob Knight, their dictatorial Olympic coach, and two candidates for the 1984 U.S. team, Michael Jordan and Patrick Ewing, were taking advantage of it by horsing around in their dorm room. Wild in-room wrestling matches were a major diversion for the collegians, particularly Charles Barkley and Chuck Person, two Auburn teammates who went at it pretty hard before they ended up on Knight's very roomy chopping block. Jordan, who had just completed his junior year at North Carolina, was heading for the NBA, while Ewing would be going back to complete his senior year at Georgetown. They were already good friends, having first met at high school all-star games and, more eventfully, in the 1982 NCAA final. It was there that a jump shot by North Carolina freshman Jordan led the Tar Heels to a 63-62 victory over freshman Ewing and his Georgetown Hoyas. Though no one realized the significance of it at the time, Ewing became the first of many great players to be stopped short of the finish line by Jordan. The 6'6 Jordan had the 7-foot Ewing in a headlock. Neither young man was angry, but that didn't mean it wasn't semi-serious. To Jordan, everything of a competitive nature had some degree of seriousness. "Finally, Ewing," said Uncle, and when the big center awoke the next morning, he couldn't move his neck. Man, was this going to be a tough conversation. "Coach, I can't practice this morning," Ewing told Knight after screwing up his courage. "What happened?" said Knight, and Ewing was forced to tell the whole story, giving up Jordan as the culprit. "So I sat out, and man, Coach Knight was mad," Ewing remembers years later. "But only at me. Michael? Nothing happened to him. Nothing ever happened to Michael." Yes, the summer of 1984 was a glorious one for Michael Jordan, the first of many, despite the fact that he had been initially resistant to the idea of competing in Los Angeles. "I was a little intimidated by Coach Knight," Jordan told me in the summer of 2011. "I didn't like his tactics. Heard he ragged players, swore at them, and I didn't want to spend the summer being berated by someone. So he sought the counsel of his coach, Dean Smith, with whom he had a kind of father-son relationship, although Jordan's own father, James, was a strong influence in his life. Coach Smith told me that all Knight wants to see is the fundamentals of the game of basketball," Jordan said. Even in casual conversation, Jordan uses the phrase, "the game of basketball," almost as if he's describing Holy Writ. "I had those fundamentals, so there shouldn't be a problem. And once I got there, I just saw a man who demanded you play the game a certain way and don't make the same mistake twice. I didn't." The summer was glorious, too, for the men who ran amateur basketball in the United States. The Olympic boycott of 1980, which had so soured them against President Jimmy Carter, was a distant memory. A solid team, full of eager collegians, anchored by Jordan, whose singular skills, if not known worldwide, were certainly recognized in the United States, where he had just finished a gilded college career, was about to storm to the gold medal in Los Angeles. When the Soviets returned the 1980 favor by boycotting the L.A. Games, it seemed not to matter all that much. The U.S. collegians would have beaten that group anyway, or so went the thinking. Knight was right out of the amateur hoops handbook, a tyrant of the first order, but one of them, a dedicated, if sometimes out of control, disciple of ABA USA, the group that ran amateur hoops at the time. "With Bobby in charge," says C.M. Newton, one of his assistants, "there was no hoopla. It was straight down the path." Knight made the Olympic trials a Darwinian exercise from start to finish. More than 100 players were invited, and they got cut 20 at a time. Karl Malone, a muscular but largely unknown player from Louisiana Tech, remembers that the early cuts had an impersonal feel. "You went through the lunch line in this big cafeteria where they had a big bulletin board," remembers Malone. "If your name was on the board, you were in." One day Malone's name wasn't on the board. Eventually, that freak of nature named Charles Barkley was cut. So was a guard named John Stockton. There was a segment of the basketball population that didn't completely buy into Jordan when he was at North Carolina, where, as common logic had it, the only one who could stop him was Smith, a rigid fundamentalist whose teams often held the ball. Anyone with one working eye and a semi-functional cortex knew that Jordan was going to be spectacular in the pros, but one supposition was that he would be a Clyde Drexler type, referencing the University of Houston product who had just finished his first season with the Portland Trailblazers. That is, flashy, but sometimes out of control. A scorer, but not a shooter. A fan favorite, but not a coach's choice. Though that impression would endure in some quarters until 1991, the year Jordan won his first championship with the Chicago Bulls, the basketball cognoscenti watching the LA game saw what it really had in Jordan. He was a player who could break a zone with a jumper, lock down a high-scoring opponent, run the offense from the point if he had to. He could please Bobby Knight, for God's sake. The 1984 Olympics, says David Falk, his agent, was Michael's coming-out party. Behind Jordan, the United States tore through the Olympic competition, winning its 8 games by an average of 30 points, and in the process drawing comparisons to the great Oscar Robertson-Jerry West team of 1960 that won gold in Rome. The United States beat Canada 78-59 in the semifinals and destroyed Spain 96-65 in the gold medal game, and the name Michael was on the lips of basketball fans everywhere. It had become evident that Jordan was the chosen one, and no one knew that better than Falk, who had already commenced endorsement negotiations with Nike that would forever change the way athletes are marketed. Jordan had always worn Converse, the sneaker of choice for both his college coach and the United States Olympic Committee, and the de facto historical choice of most hoopsters. Michael has since said that he, like many players, believed that Adidas made the best product. Had he gotten a decent offer, Jordan probably would have signed with either Converse or Adidas. But Falk saw Nike as hungrier and more market-savvy than either of them. Both Magic Johnson and Larry Bird, the two biggest names in the pro game, wore Converse. But the company, coasting on its past rep, did almost nothing with them. Think about it. Magic had an immortal nickname, a 1,000-kilowatt smile, a flashy game, a glitzy home base, and a championship resume. Yet in the early years of his career, Converse didn't come close to capitalizing on his appeal, a decision that cost both Magic and the company millions. Way before Michael came into the league, says Falk, Magic could have owned the world. At Nike, by contrast, executives such as Rob Strasser saw in Jordan a new horizon for the endorsement game. Plus, Nike needed to make a major move since the running boom of the 1970s had petered out. It was a company that prided itself on taking chances, so it had decided to blow its entire marketing budget, $500,000, on advertising that would feature Jordan, plus what it would have to pay him to wear the sneakers. Still, Jordan was resistant to Nike, which he had never worn and knew very little about. The night before he, his father, and Falk were to fly to Nike headquarters in Beaverton, Oregon, Jordan told his mom that he wasn't going, but she wouldn't hear of it. "You will be on that plane, Michael," said Dolores Jordan. So he was on the plane. At that first meeting, Peter Moore, Nike's head designer, showed Jordan and Falk the sketches he had made of Air Jordan shoes, warm-up suits, and apparel, all of it in black and red. "Devil's colors," as Jordan told Falk. Jordan never blinked, never smiled, never said much of anything, and everybody in the room figured that he was underwhelmed. But after the meeting, he admitted that he was swayed, and Falk negotiated a 5-year, $2.5 million deal that, like so many deals over the years, was supposed to bring the world to an end. So was born Air Jordan. At first, Jordan hated the red and black shoe. "I'll look like a clown," he said. But he relented and wore them, after which the NBA ruled them illegal for some bizarre reason, fining Jordan $5,000 per game, a sum that Nike paid with a secret smile. A design compromise was eventually reached, and the major thing the fines had accomplished was to turn Jordan's shoes into one of the biggest stories of the 1984-85 season and gather worldwide attention for Nike. Rod Thorne, the Bulls' general manager at the time, asked Falk, "What are you trying to do? Turn him into a tennis player?" "Now you get it," said the agent. Chapter 3. The Commissioner and the Inspector of Meat. The NBA sticks a tentative toe into international waters. Late in 1985, David Stern and Russ Granick, Commissioner and Deputy Commissioner of the NBA, received the Inspector of Meat in the league's New York offices. The FIBA boss could hardly believe his good fortune. "You have to understand where I came from," Stankovic told me recently, reflecting back on the meeting. "It was considered almost criminal just to communicate with the pro league. The amateur way was that we were not supposed to speak to them, and here I am, sitting with the commissioner, and we have a normal relationship." He was positively beaming at the memory, sounding like Sally Field receiving her Best Actress Award at the 1984 Oscars. "You like me." Stern did like him. Both men are attracted to power the way moths are to light. But there is a similar air of informality about them, too. They're not exactly regular guys, but they're smart enough to know that they should act like regular guys. And Granick, cool, careful, collected, a lawyer who had started at the NBA in 1976, was the perfect complement to Stern, who could be quick-tempered, even volcanic. After a few get-acquainted moments, Stankovic went right to the point. "I don't believe in these restrictions about who should play and who shouldn't," he said. "The best players in the world should be playing in everything, including the Olympics, but I can't do that alone." In some revisionist histories, Stern, all-seeing, all-knowing, instantly grasped the importance of aligning with FIBA, envisioning a day when NBA players were the toast of the continent and the league was flooding Europe and Asia with sneakers, T-shirts, and hoodies. Nothing could be further from the truth, and Stern, to his credit, has never claimed otherwise. It wasn't that the idea of NBA players in the Olympics slipped onto the NBA's back burner. It wasn't even on the stove. Yes, Stern saw the hypocrisy in the rules against competition. Germany's Detlef Schrempf, who played in the NBA for about $500,000 a year, was considered a professional, while Brazil's Oscar Schmidt, who played in Italy for about $1 million a year, was considered an amateur and eligible for Olympic play. Everyone saw the hypocrisy, except the empty suits who ran the Olympics. But the commissioner couldn't imagine adding the Olympics to an already full plate. "David and I thought that global basketball came with as many burdens as benefits," says Granick today. "And that's what we told Boris." However, when Stankovic suggested a competition that would include an NBA team and a couple of FIBA teams, a kind of first step, Stern said yes. "We'll host it," he said immediately. It was out of that meeting that the first McDonald's Open, which was eventually held in Milwaukee in 1987, was born. But it was never Stern's plan to get his players into the Olympics, in large part because he faced far more pressing issues. The tide was beginning to turn by the time of Stankovic's visit, but the NBA was still on relatively shaky ground. The popular "How bad was the NBA?" nugget to offer is the 1980 NBA Finals, which was on tape delay even though it pitted the Los Angeles Lakers, rookie Magic Johnson, superstar Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, against the Philadelphia 76ers, Julius Erving. But there are other ways to measure the NBA's low water marks. When Rick Welts was hired in 1982 to head up sponsorship, like all of David's guys back then, I was perfect for the job because I was young, dumb, and poor, Welts says today. The NBA literally had no business plan. It sold nothing to no one. Welts and the other young, dumb, and poor soldiers found a nation that not only didn't care about the NBA, but downright loathed it. The perception was that the NBA was mismanaged. Too many African Americans, too many drug accusations, too many teams going out of business, Welts told me in 2011. I'd call advertising agencies, and to get a return call was remarkable if you had NBA attached to your name. The priority was NFL, Major League Baseball, and college sports. The NHL would get the calls before they'd even think of investing in the NBA. As his young band of committed warriors tried to chip away at the NBA's image, it was always stern, cajoling, conniving, caterwauling. The power of everybody saying the same thing over and over again is pretty significant, says Welts. I'd come home beaten and battered after 12 hours of rejection, and the phone would ring in my room at the Summit Hotel on Lexington Avenue at 10 o'clock. It would be David, and after 15 minutes, I'd be charged up and ready to go again. Stern is so commonly called the best sports commissioner ever that he has all but retired the term. But there was certainly a bit of serendipity in his rise. It was under his watch, after all, that Michael Magic Larry descended from the heavens. And at the end of the day, the only thing a marketing man can do is shine a brighter light on the stage. If the people don't like what they see, nothing is going to happen. But Stern and others in his office figured out how to maximize the appeal of these players and leverage their popularity. And while he didn't see the full road ahead of him, the commissioner always kept an ear open to the sermons by the inspector of meat, who thought that great things would happen if the United States was able to put its stars together, bundle them up in red, white, and blue packaging, and send them off to play under a sacred set of rings. Chapter 4. The Legend. I'm the Three-Point King. Larry Bird stood on the floor of Reunion Arena in Dallas on the morning of February 8, 1986, where 8 hours later he would compete in the NBA's first three-point shooting contest during All-Star Weekend. Standing nearby was Leon Wood of the New Jersey Nets, who was now an NBA referee, but who was then one of the favorites in the competition. "Hey, Leon," Bird said, "you changed your shot lately? It looks different." That was nonsense, of course, but Wood, a second-year player known for his three-point range, he wasn't shy about attempting shots from a couple of feet behind the three-point line, looked stricken. "Man, if Larry Bird says my shot has changed, I wonder if..." Then Bird started talking about the red, white, and blue balls, the ones that would be worth 2 points instead of one, at each of the five racks of five balls that were set up for the competition. Bird said they felt slippery. Wood looked stricken again. Scratch Leon Wood from the list of potential winners. The others would come later. At this point in time, mid-season 1986, Larry Joe Bird was the undisputed king of the NBA. He was on his way to his third straight Most Valuable Player award, and his Boston Celtics were on their way to the NBA title. But it went beyond that. It was Bird's bravado, his utter belief in himself, his trash talk, legendary around the league, if largely unknown to the general public since Bird did it subtly, the street game that came wrapped in a pasty package that made the early to mid-1980s his game, his time. Bird's package of skills, shooting, rebounding, passing, court savvy, competitiveness, had been there since his rookie season, 1979 and 80. We tend to think of him as the ultimate workaholic, endlessly polishing a shooting stroke that he had fabricated back in his high school days. And to an extent he was, but he was also a natural, someone to whom, as he always admitted, the game came easily. He just saw it differently from most everybody else. Bird well knew that at age 29 and 7 years into his Hall of Fame career, there was nobody like him. And that was even taking into account his creaky back, which he first injured in the summer of 1985 when he was shoveling gravel at the home he had built for his mother in his native French Lick, Indiana. Even early in that marvelous 1985-86 season, Bird had sometimes needed the magic hands of his physiotherapist, Dan Dyrek, just to get out of a prone position. A month into the season, Dyrek had been called to Bird's suburban Boston home and couldn't believe that the star was in that much pain. But the back gradually improved. It would never really get better. And Bird was on his way to another transcendent year. Shortly after All-Star Weekend, SI sent me to write a story about whether Bird was, in fact, the greatest player ever. Magazines love these greatest ever stories. Men, in particular, are inveterate list makers, adept at wasting hour after hour in fervent arguments about whether Keith Moon or John Bonham was the greater drummer, or whether Taxi Driver or Raging Bull was the greater De Niro vehicle. And, predictably, I got into the spirit and pretty much decided that Bird was the greatest ever, backed up by several quotes from unbiased observers, one being John Wooden. "I've always considered Oscar Robertson to be the best player in the game," the Wizard of Westwood told me. "Now I'm not so sure that Larry Bird isn't." Never mind that the following season I would find a different all-time best, Magic, and a couple of years after that another, Jordan. That's how it goes in the list-making business. You have to have a short memory. I recall several things from that Bird story, beyond him telling me that Bonanza was his favorite TV show. Chuck Daly, later, his dream team coach told me that Bird deliberately once knocked me ass over tin cups after he drilled a jumper in front of the Detroit Pistons bench. Celtics teammate Danny Ainge told me that Bird was so good that from time to time he deliberately dribbled into trouble just to increase the degree of difficulty on the play, something that Bird confirmed. Years later, Kobe Bryant would be crucified when Phil Jackson claimed that Kobe did the same thing. Bill Walton related a night when Bird dribbled into the corner, drew a triple team, then zipped him a pass that traveled through Joe Barry Carroll's legs. Bird was also not shy about professing his proficiency at other sports, something that always fascinates me about pro athletes. Jordan always mused about how well he could have done not only in baseball, a question to which we later got an answer, but also at sports such as track and football. Bird told me, in all seriousness, that he was as adept at backyard badminton as he was at basketball. He also said that he wasn't weight room strong, but cock strong. A farmer's expression that has nothing to do with the penis. And he loved to brag about his softball skills, a sport he enjoyed playing with his brothers for Terre Haute's Platalene 500 Carpet Center team as a power hitter and first baseman outfielder. Bird had shattered a knuckle in a softball injury he had suffered years later and always claimed he couldn't field the basketball as well after that. I never knew whether to believe that. I was particularly intrigued by Bird's ambidexterity, which went well beyond his ability to dribble with his left hand. Bird looked utterly comfortable shooting left-handed, as he did from time to time, and he both ate and signed autographs with his left. He just grew up that way. He says that he always picked up a pencil and wrote with his left, yet when a teacher sent him to the blackboard to write, he used his right hand. There was about Bird the mystique of a street hustler, always with something up his sleeve, always some kind of trump card chicanery at the ready. Quinn Buckner, a former Bird teammate who would later be on the committee that would select the Dream Team, tells of Bird's wizardry during a practice shooting game called Knockout. "You'd be ready to win, and all of a sudden, I'm not making this up, Larry would throw up a shot that would not only knock your ball away from the basket, but would also go in itself," says Buckner. The man could play pool and basketball at the same time. Buckner conjures up a moment during a game when he was streaking down court, and Bird wound up to throw him a long pass, despite the fact that a defender was directly in the line between them. So Larry throws this thing that starts way out to the left, veers around the defender, and curves right into my hands, Buckner says. Nobody in history, nobody, threw those kinds of passes. That Bird had even agreed to compete in this 1986 three-point contest was a triumph for the NBA, because no one was quite sure how that particular sideshow was going to turn out. But Bird had signed on for a few reasons. It appealed to the gunslinger aspect of his game. He loved the pre- and post-practice shooting games in which he engaged with teammates Ainge and Jerry Seisting. He loved the idea that, as talk about the three-point contest heated up, he was not necessarily considered the favorite, since players such as Craig Hodges, Dale Ellis, and Wood were long-distance specialists. With a game on the line, Bird was everybody's choice, of course, but that was not necessarily the case in an exhibition, where his relatively slow delivery would be a liability. Bird wanted to show that such an analysis was flawed. And so, a few minutes before the competition in Dallas was to begin, and 7 of the 8 players who would be participating in the three-point contest were gathered in a locker room, suddenly the door burst open and in strode Bird asking, "Who's coming in second?" Then he reiterated his feelings about the slippery red, white, and blue balls. It was pretty much over at that point. Bird didn't even remove his warm-up jacket for the first 2 rounds. He always insisted that it was not a fuck-you move, but just how he felt comfortable, and went up against sharpshooter Hodges in the final. It was no contest. Now in his absurdly bright red East All-Star uniform, Bird drained 9 shots in a row at one point, and even deliberately banked in the red, white, and blue ball near the end. Bird was ecstatic. His first comments were directed to his Boston teammates who had kidded him that he wouldn't win, and specifically to veteran M.L. Carr, who used to claim that he was the three-point king. So Bird stole his line. "I'm the three-point king," Bird yelped over and over. "I'm the three-point king." Even later in his career, it would bring a smile to his face when someone called him the three-point king. He was, too, in a way that Bird didn't even intend at the time. He probably wasn't the first great three-point shooter, a title that might belong to Dale Ellis, but he was the first true superstar to incorporate the three-point shot into his game, and he remains the greatest combination of player and three-point shooter in NBA history. Bird would win the contest the next 2 years, too, but there was something about that first one. It came in the middle of a championship season, and it seemed to say everything about Bird. The deadly concentration, the balls-out confidence, the pure joy he got from playing the game better than anyone else. There was just something about Larry, something that earned him the sobriquet of legend. Even if we allow for the fact that Jordan was a better all-around player and Magic, 5 championships to Bird's 3, was a greater winner. We cannot ever divorce Bird from his ethnicity. The fact that millions of white youngsters all over the world gravitated to Bird, found him almost godlike, is not racist, but it is certainly racial. Ditto for the millions who detested him purely because he was white, theorizing that his fame, trumpeted by a mostly white press, was chimerical. But those who knew him knew that his grittiness was hard-earned, legit, that his darkness on the edge of town upbringing, his alcoholic father committed suicide when Bird was 18, was the foundation of his character. Years later, Patrick Ewing told me everything I needed to know about what other players thought about Bird. Though Ewing grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and idolized Celtics legend Bill Russell, he was not a fan of Bird or the contemporary Celtics. He didn't explain why. He didn't have to. The Celtics were the white team and Bird the white leader. All through high school, says Ewing, my friends and I hated him and hated his team. But something changed when Ewing entered the league and faced those flinty eyes of the hick from French Lick. So he picked up the phone and dialed his friends. You know all that shit we were talking back then? Ewing told them. Well, forget about it. This motherfucker right here is the truth. Chapter 5. The Outcast. Isaiah throws it away, then throws it all away. He had it in his hands, right there, the whole game, the whole season, his long battle to make the NBA's terrific triumvirate a fantastic foursome, all of it, right there. His Detroit Pistons were leading the Boston Celtics by 1 point in Boston Garden in Game 5 of the 1987 Eastern Conference Finals. There were only 5 seconds left, and all Isaiah Thomas had to do was successfully inbound the ball to a teammate, and victory was his. Easy. Isaiah was then, by his reckoning, the smartest guy in the room, all the time, every time. And he wasn't far wrong. But then the situation started to devolve. Coach Chuck Daly motioned for a timeout, which the Pistons had, but nobody saw him. None of the veterans on the court, including Joe Dumars, Bill Laimbeer, Adrian Dantley, or Thomas himself, thought to do it either. Isaiah's best option was Laimbeer, a good foul shooter, and Larry Bird knew this too. So Bird faked as if he was covering Dantley and darted toward Laimbeer just as Thomas, now pressed by the 5-second clock, threw it in that direction. This was classic Bird, who always had trouble staying in front of his own man, but, like a classroom busybody, was a master at horning in on everyone else's affairs. Bird thought for a moment about fouling Laimbeer, but, as he said later, Thomas's pass seemed to stay in the air forever. Bird made the steal, then immediately whirled, found teammate Dennis Johnson streaking down the lane, fed him a perfect pass, and watched as Johnson banked in a layup that gave the Celtics a 108-107 victory and a 3-2 series lead. It was not then that Thomas severely hurt his chances of being on a dream team that wasn't even born yet. It was a few minutes later. Thomas was caught in what was then the worst place for an NBA player who had just lost a tough one. The visitors' locker room in ancient Boston Garden, one step up from a junior high lavatory, complete with tepid water, open stalls, and the aroma of a prison mess hall. It was crowded, the air thick with tension, the season, all but gone, and much hostility toward the Celtics already roiling in Isaiah's system. Indeed, a fight between Bird and Laimbeer, Isaiah's good buddy, had erupted during Game 3, a 122-104 Pistons victory. Laimbeer had been fined $5,000 for taking Bird down, and Bird, $2,000 for throwing the ball at Laimbeer. Dennis Rodman, a rookie, then, as far as we know, dressing only like a man, decided to offer an opinion on Bird. I wasn't there for the beginning of the conversation, but Rodman said that Bird was overrated and had won 3 straight MVP awards just because he was white. The attention then turned to Thomas, which was when I arrived. Thomas was asked about Rodman's comments and said he had to agree with Rodman. Then, his brain evidently in full lockdown mode, added, "Larry Bird is a very, very good basketball player, but if he was black, he'd be just another guy." Then Isaiah did the Isaiah laugh, familiar to anyone who had been around him, a little chuckle accompanied by the part angel, part devil Isaiah smile. Days later, when he went on an Ask for Absolution tour that culminated at the NBA Finals in Los Angeles, Isaiah, standing next to an obviously uncomfortable Bird, would offer up the laugh as proof that he was joshing. But the laugh, then as now, never comes across that way. It is inscrutable, one that could mean he was joking, or could mean he was as serious as a priest at high mass. It was impossible to tell. Isaiah was, and remains today, a solipsist, his reality the only reality. At the press conference, Isaiah made some legitimate points about how black athletes are sometimes judged differently than white athletes. Whites are frequently called heady and hard-working, while blacks are presented as just naturally talented. There is something to that, but it was a subject for a different time and, in any case, should not have included Bird. Better that Isaiah's defense...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.